All right. What is this here? All right. Are we recording? I can't tell.
It's showing up here.
Yeah, I can't tell whether I'm recording on this one or not. Okay. All right. Okay. Geez, I don't know. Here, let me stop for a second, Jerry. All right, I think we're okay. Well, like everybody else back in the day, in the late 60s and early 70s, I read the novels of Hermann Hesse. I enjoyed them, but they were not a special favorite of mine. But there was one exception, or maybe two. Hesse was a friend and a patient of Carl Gustav Jung. In fact, in one of the novels of Hermann Hesse, he based the characters on Jung's personality typology. And that novel was Narcissus and Goldman. And Narcissus was made to be an introverted thinking type. And Goldman was made to be an extroverted feeling type. And he did a pretty good job of describing them. But in the course of the novel, Goldman, who became a sculptor, said something to the effect of, after he has just completed something, he has a feeling of emptiness, of being hollow, and very turned in on self, as though caved in. Nowhere in any kind of literature of any time have I ever seen that in print before. And it is exact. It's something that I experience every week. After I've given a talk, no matter how the talk went, this has always happened. Even if the talk was satisfactory or just okay, I still feel empty and I still feel unhappy with myself. And this seems to be a universal occurrence everywhere in the physical world. That after an assertion or an exertion of some type has been made, there is a feeling of emptiness and interning. Even if you take a thing like cell division, when the cell divides and there are two new cells, after that activity, both cells are quiescent for a while. They rest, where if cells can turn inward, I suppose that's what they do. So this is sort of a psychic vacuum. And that psychic vacuum is extremely important in that when you've given something out, it's as if you have excised a psychic tumor. And everything that connected to it, that was regulating it or feeding it or taking waste from it, is still there and it's still active. And you can see the whole creative process, though a tumor is not a good thing to like into a creative process. So this is a period that is very introspective and very reflective, and it's not a time that one should waste in celebration. So every week, once a week, I have a day of retrospective reflection, whether I want it or not. And since I have the sun in Scorpio, I'm pretty good at doing postmortems. And as a result of that, from the last time we gave a talk in this series, there are a couple things I'd like to revisit. Not to change the view of them altogether, but to give additional information and to present them in a little bit better way. Now, the first thing, you're not getting it?
I'm getting it, but it's clipping so much, and then the next thing is real quiet. I think I'll try putting it, because this thing is going all over the place. Just try putting it. Try putting it there, and it's not going to move around in front of your when you breathe or whatever. It just
I've been thinking of having some kind of extender on there that I could put it down there, like steady like.
I'm going to just check the.
All right. All right. The first thing I want to mention is how feeble our comprehension and understanding of reality really is. We don't even get some of the most basic things that we think that we do. That is one of the first problems with something like that. Because we're familiar with something and we see it regularly, we think we know it, when we probably do not know it. Or if we do, we don't know it very deeply. The classic example of that is often given is Isaac Newton. People have apples fall on their head all the time. But nobody ever asked the question why apples don't fall up and why they always fall down instead of up, down, or sideways. So let's take a silly example. This is going to be really silly and it's going to be crazy talk. We don't know how and why things move. Why something goes from one place to another. If I move from here to here and move back, how is that even possible? Because it's something that we do every day, and we think we know what we're doing, and we think we know what's behind it, but we can't go to physics. Because according to physics, a body at rest tends to stay at rest until it is given momentum, until a force is applied to it. And what is usually meant by that in the experiments that you do in a physics laboratory is that the force is applied from without. Well, in our case, that didn't work because when I moved over there, nobody pushed me. So we can't say that there was a force that came from without. Now, it's probably a force that comes from within. And physicists and physiologists have measured this, how the body is capable of this kind of movement and that kind of movement from within. But that doesn't explain why we can move at all. Now, as mystics, we understand that there is something that is in us that is always alive. And it's always in perpetual motion. And it is always volitional. whether we're in touch with that or not, but we have learned to draw on that. We have learned to will the ever-living substance or ever-livingness within us to cause action. Now, when I moved from one place to another, it was intentional, and it came from my self-conscious being. So we know we can start and stop on our own. So we have something in ourselves which is beyond physics and it's beyond physiology. It is something very much beyond. Now, if we watch ourselves, or if we follow the path within us that allows us to move or not move, through a number of transcendences, we can feel the energy in ourselves, and we can transcend to the desire to move, and we can transcend that to the thought to move. And so we can even get beyond the thought, and we can know from whence the movement or anything else came into being that is in our existence. And this is something that in order to really know what we're doing, we have to be even more self-conscious and deliberate than we are. This is the experiment of being able to get beyond thought, to get to the willing spirit, to get to the spirit that does what we do. This was called by the alchemists the great experiment. Now, lest we are too full of ourselves for what we can do and what we eventually will be able to do, it must be pointed out, as we're trying right now to do, that we haven't really answered the question in the most basic sense. We have a dim experiential understanding of movement, at least movement in our own body, but we really haven't answered the question in a deeper way, in a more comprehensive way. So we have only a limited outlook. So to get beyond that limited outlook, let's take it to the ultimate, the silly ultimate. Now, the silly ultimate takes place in ultimate space, which is sometimes called mathematical space, and which some Christian mystics call cosmic root substance. In the ultimate space is comprised of infinite potential loci. They're usually referred to as points. They are points that have no size, none whatsoever. They have only location. Having no size, they are contiguous. They're touching. So ultimate space is as dense as something can possibly be, because all the locations are touching each other. Of course, we have to remind ourselves that when we conceive of this, when we conceive of ultimate space, we're conceiving of it with three-dimensional consciousness. And there may be less or more or an infinite number of dimensions. If we use three-dimensional consciousness, that's all right for what we're doing, just as long as we realize that we're not doing the be-all, end-all. In this, we have to realize, or our comprehension or the understanding that we do have, we recognize that ultimate space or silly space must be, because we have a demonstrable understanding of space. Even though it's only three-dimensional space, we know that there is such a thing as location, and that it is conceivable that there is pure location, where it is nothing but location. So we would say that it cannot not be. And everything that exists in one way or another must exist in ultimate space. Thus, any object in any dimensionality must also exist in ultimate space. Oh, this silliness is hard to keep in. If something exists in ultimate space, it must be comprised of a set of locations, or loci, or points, as we're calling them, in ultimate space. Then, since the points in ultimate space are absolute loci, the object itself must be absolute. And if an object is absolute, it cannot move. An infinitely dense object cannot pass through an infinitely dense space. So moving an absolute object is as impossible, and it's impossible, and it's like a question that can't be answered. So we have a conundrum in that we do this every day. Things move. It is, we know that they move. We can prove it to ourselves. However, anything is possible in the absolute, so we have to rethink it all. Now, if we examine ourselves, when we go through this exercise, we see something very different. We conceive of an object, and when we conceive of ultimate space or cosmic root substance, we do so in our consciousness. We just did that. We conceived of an object in our consciousness. This means that our consciousness is as ultimate as ultimate space. And it isn't necessarily space-bound. It isn't necessarily location-bound. Now, mystics all call the source and vehicle of ultimate consciousness, they call it spirit. Whereas the ultimate space in its densest state is called matter, in the generic sense. Not matter like this matter, but a universal matter or an absolute matter. So what we're talking about is a degree of consciousness. Now, like some mystics, like Max Heindel, claims that what we call divine spirit is the opposite pole of cosmic root substance, so that the potentiality of form in matter is the opposite pole of consciousness in spirit. So that they're two part of the same thing. This is a duality, a monistic duality, in that everything is connected. Now, since this is a matter of degree, everything between ultimate space and ultimate matter is relative. and the degree of relativity is in terms of dimensions, is in terms of point of view and matter in space. Now, in mystics of all times, it's a very ancient concept. The mystics from old up to the present describe a creative manifestation as a carving out or hollowing out of space, meaning ultimate space. In the Rosicrucian CosmoConception, a description of it is given, but you have to remember it's a highly contextual description, and it's not to be taken completely as it appears, as it comes to the inner imaginative presentment. It states something to the effect that the second attribute of spirit selects and sets up points which are called atoms, but not like, this is not like chemistry called atom, just these are points. These are the old definition of atom, not the new. So some of absolute space is selected, and contextually it says that they are given an angle on axes. So, and it's implied that this is a tonal process, like St. John's Gospel, in the beginning was the Word. So the second attribute of spirit selects and sets up the part of absolute space or silly space that is going to be manifest. The third attribute then sets the atom spinning in their representative consciousness. And the result is that some degree of matter is manifest or is hollowed out of ultimate space. This is how I understand the process of hollowing. How we can move, because we are in a hollowed out space and the things are only involved some of the stuff of space. There's much more that we could go into, but I don't want to go into that because it would be too much. Now, all of this agrees pretty well with modern physics and astronomy, because even the most dense matter, like a neutron star or something like that, even in that, there's a tremendous distance. There's a tremendous distance between stars, in that entire galaxies can pass through other galaxies with not very many collisions. This is a complete sideline that just came to mind when I just said that. The astronomers have found the fastest moving object in space, and it's a star. And it's a star that is, I think it's even in our Milky Way galaxy, that was part of a binary star. And the other part of it went supernova, and when it blasted, it sent this star off like a slingshot, and it's breezing through space at a really, really fast thing. Sorry to go into that side trip, but it's just something I wanted to share because it's so pretty. But at any rate, this agrees with clairvoyant observation, in that the higher one proceeds in the spiritual worlds, the greater the degree of density or contiguity. Like, the more the hollowing out is in what we call the densest matter, which is wrong. It's the most solidified and it is the most hardened matter, but it is not the most dense. In fact, at one time, life spirit, which as we said is pure spirit, and is free, it's much more on the matter side of things, or almost purely on the spirit side of things and not on the matter side at all. Life spirit used to be called a crystallium, because the crystallium is a crystal that is made of pure indivisible light, closely packed light. Now, the point that we want to find in all of this is that what we call worlds are sustained relativity of hollowing out, whether the world or the state of being is called more spirit-like or more matter-like. So if we want to have higher states of consciousness, we have to realize that we are now locked in to seeing reality with three-dimensional consciousness. And we have to be able to let go of seeing things in three-dimensional consciousness. People who have experienced the fourth dimension and can even draw objects that can lead one to that experience say that it is a letting go. And I believe Krishnamurti is right in all of this. We're afraid to do that. Fear is a big part of it. Fear is not of the unknown. Fear is of losing the known. And we're afraid to lose the consciousness that we have now. It's all right. You know, it's like taking a child out for a drive. The house will be there when we get back. You know, in the case of insecurity, three-dimensional consciousness will be there if we go to a higher level of consciousness. If we don't do that, we're like horses. Horses will run back into a burning stable because that stable is where they have associated security with. And when there's a big panic, they'll chase back into the stable, into the fire, and even their demise. We don't want to be insecure because of our relationship to higher dimensions. All right, we've got that out of the way. We can see how motion, as we understand it, is in relative space. In relative space, the degree of relative space or the relationships in relative space are what we call dimensions. So let's look at something that I presented very faultily last time. We said that the most limited conception of space is point space. Sometimes point space is called non-dimensional, but that isn't always. In point space, there is only one reference, the point itself. There's no reference to anything outside of itself. In point space, there's only one point. Now, in terms of ultimate space, the way we just looked at it, this means this is the maximum of hollowing out. You've hollowed it out all the way down to one point. And then that point is sort of an irrefragable location, irrefragable point. Line space adds a dimension. So it brings things to a point where you have one-dimensional consciousness. Things are forward on the line, and you have a consciousness of one point relative to a second point. So that point is either before you or behind you. So linear consciousness is the next degree up in consciousness, and everything is hollowed out but a line. The inline space, there is perspective to something outside of a point, but it is only in one direction. Now, plane consciousness is called two-dimensional consciousness because a point can conceive of two different directions, forward, back, or one side, or the other. So you can see that there are two dimensions. Plane consciousness is derived from linear consciousness by taking the whole line and moving it in that new direction. That's the way it's usually done in mathematical demonstrations of it. The whole line, or that whole projection of consciousness along two or more points, is moved outside of itself. Again, there has to be a carrying of consciousness outside of the current dimensional relationship of consciousness that we have. Volume consciousness is derived from a plane getting outside of itself. The form of volume consciousness is called three-dimensional consciousness. This is where we spend most of our time. In volume consciousness, a plane, the whole plane gets outside of itself. The point that we first began with non-dimensional consciousness, is still itself. No matter whether it is in one, two, or three dimensions. Manifolds are various areas of experience or dimensionality beyond volume. That is, a volume getting outside of itself, and then beyond that, a manifold getting outside of itself to another manifold, and so on. And each successive manifold has a higher consciousness that we call dimensionality. Again, the point is still the point in that same thing. The location is not lost. Now, in the talk previous to this, it is said that mathematicians find that the higher the dimensionality, the after a certain point, I don't know at what point it is, the higher dimensions are internal. Even the extensivity, because when we're talking about space, we're talking about extensive relationship rather than intensive relationship, but even the extensivity is inward. The way the mathematicians describe it is they say that dimensions are rolled up inside of a point. This is, I think, they get up to about 12 or 13 as being reasonable. Again, the point, the original locus, is still the same. It doesn't matter how many dimensions. See, this is the way that silly space carries itself through, even into the greatest limitation or carving out of it. Now, there are all sorts of other things that we could say about this, but I think the idea is a little bit clearer as a picture, and I'd like to mention some of the things that do come out of it. That is, it's interesting to note that the rolled up interdimensionality is very similar to monad philosophy that has been developed by mystics over thousands of years. That is to say that in each point within itself is the entire universe turning inward, because it's still the same one, still the same absolute. The most recent expression of it that I can think of was from Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, the famous mathematician. He was an exponent or an expressor of monad theory, in that he said that each of us is like a soap bubble, and we have the whole universe in that soap bubble, and the only thing that is different is the point of view. And this reflects some of the ideas that go way back to India. So what the mathematicians come up with in a purely theoretical way is not in disagreement with what mystics have found in their own inner experience. Each individual is instantaneously omnipresent in every event that is taking place anywhere in the universe. And in the most recent talk, the talk before this, it was mentioned that spatial dimensions are more extensive and temporal dimensions are more intensive. And that part seems to be confirmed by mathematics, by the fact that the more deeply one is involved in matter, the more we are numb to intensity, and the more extended our viewpoints are, so that when we get into chemical embodiments, even the centers of our being, you know, like in spirit, like in the region of ideational thought, we are at one with ourself as a divine being. And all of the different foci that we have in manifest consciousness are concentric, and they're all in one place. But when we get in our physical body, the seed of the physical body is in the heart. Whereas for the etheric body, it's in the solar plexus. And for the desire body, it's delineated. There's much more extensivity to the central expression of the self or of the one thing the further we go into matter. All right, fine. That clears up. Oh, there's another thing about that there's a less possible form the deeper we go into dimensionality. Like, for example, in three-dimensional consciousness of perfect figures, they're called the Platonic solids, there are only five of them. But if you have plane consciousness, the equilateral geometric figures that are infinite. You can have a square, you can have a triangle, you can have a perfect pentagon, you can carry it on as many as you want to go. But if you go to n dimensions, the mathematicians tell us that there's only one perfect figure that's possible in the nth dimension, and that is the tetrahedron. So I'm trying to point out a bunch of ideas that are probably not of interest to anyone. All right. The other holdover from the talk preceding this talk is an image that I would like to revisit. And the reason I would like to revisit is that it is a perfect segue into the topic for this evening, which will be very short. I'd be surprised if this would all last more than an hour. The world that we live in and the way we see it is different from all of the other worlds. I'm talking about the chemical subdivision of the physical world. It's extremely limited. One of the features of this is the limitations lead to great ramifications of complexity. And that indicates specialization. Just all of the microenvironments in the world and all the specialized organisms that are living in it are a perfect example. In science and other academic pursuits, the degree of specialization has gotten so high that it's counterproductive, that there cannot be general advances in humanity because there isn't necessarily conversation between the different specializations. And these different specializations cannot be put into proportion because we have suited our consciousness to one special little thing and not to a general understanding of all. Even without this academic artificial specialization, the manifestation of this world must be specialized to be possible. Now, we talked about this a little bit last time. We talked about light in the life spirit. And in this plane, because it is what it is, light has a source, a specific directional source. For us here on Earth, the primary source of light is the sun. So when we face the sun, without any obstruction. We call that day, and we are filled with light, and the energy in that light is responsible for everything that goes on. When we face away from that direct life, that direct light, the earth itself filters out or blocks the light, and we have darkness and we have night. Now, in the inner worlds, especially in life spirit, there is a generalized origin of light. The origin of light is everywhere. And since life spirit is more time-oriented and less space-oriented, anywhere is everywhere. This is the word is often said sometimes, that only in life spirit can you be in two places at the same time, because two places are at one at the same time. It's a much different kind of consciousness at all. So the light issues from everywhere. And this is shown in the Bible, in the Apocalypse of St. John. The being that represents Christ says, "And there was no night," meaning to say that after we leave the chemical region of the physical world and it gets dissolved back into the ethers, there will be no darkness, at least of the kind that we know now. It's from that image that we want to proceed. Light, even inner light, is radiant. It's one of the expressions of the generosity of divinity. It radiates. It shines forth from within. It gives. It creates. Now, in life spirit, everything is inward. Everything is within. So in life spirit, everything shines from within to within. When we think of radiance, we think of rays or vectors of light. Rays or vectors of light are direct expressions of will. The will to be, it radiates out. That's the will of divine spirit, which is behind life spirit. And divine spirit is much more than a light source. It is a source of vector radiation, contiguous vectors all in all directions. Now, there is a principle that applies here in the three-dimensional chemical region of the physical world that can give us some understanding of what we're trying to get to. And that is that any time that there is a vector of energy proceeding in one direction, around that vector, a force field is created. It's like a living force field. It's energetic. Though when we're talking about life spirit, those words mean something very different. Now, if we imagine a world where everywhere in that world is a radiance of vectors projecting out, but the out is within, so that's really hard to say, then we have a quasi-materialistic conception of what life spirit is like. This means that since there is a radiance that is going out from everywhere at the same time, around all of that radiance, there is a field of life, an energetic spiritual life. So, it's described, for example, Plotinus describes it very beautifully when he experiences life spirit. He says it's brimming and bristling with life. Not necessarily just moving life, but meaningful life. Life is the very nature of life spirit. That's why it is called life spirit. Now, in this world, one of the effects of life is change. Everything that lives changes, even if it's just changing within itself without any proper external motion. Even inanimate minerals change from the mechanical effects of life. So where there's life, there's change. Thus we can see that when we're approaching the quality of life spirit that is life itself, the very essence of life spirit is change. And change means that things are new. So the essence of life spirit is complete newness. There's complete rejuvenation. When people like Ponce de Leon went looking for the fountain of youth, he was looking here, and that's the mistake. But everything, including consciousness, is born new all of the time in life spirit. And once again, the being that represents Christ in the apocalypse says, "Behold, I make all things new." In life spirit, whatever modicum of form there is perpetually recreated, perpetually regenerated. Now this requires a much different kind of consciousness than our current consciousness to even begin to grasp this or to appreciate it. Every object in ultimate space is recreated, and that is how things move. It's recreated in consciousness at the other pole. So even if I move from here to here and back, my body in that period of time has been recreated. It has been recreated in absolute space, and probably even in this. Now this newness, it's a lot like the newness of a new car. It has that new car smell. This isn't like that. It doesn't wear out. It's always new, and it always has that wonder that novelty has. It just doesn't tire out. Now, as we said before, the experience of truth in life spirit is like a perpetual dawning. Oh, the truth is coming to me. And we can see that in this experience of life spirit, it is always new. It isn't just that we're just waking up to something that is there or was always there. We're waking up, and the thing that we're waking up to is completely regenerate, completely rejuvenescent as we're with it. This is a very, very different kind of consciousness. There is no death, there is no darkness anywhere in this. Now, we're told by adepts that there is, in fact, a memory in life spirit. A memory of everything that has been and that will eventually come to be. Not that it's all played out, not all the details, is there in life spirit. Everything in our whole solar creation. Now, when we think of memory, we think of etching people's names and such into tombstones. That's supposed to be a lasting memory. It'll last long after everybody who's ever seen that tombstone will have passed on. Sometimes we think of magnetic impressions as memory. At best, for most of us, memory is being able to call back the pictures in the reflecting ether and live in them. But none of these things is anything like life spirit memory. Everything, every form, every matter has been stripped away from the form side of things, from the matter side of things, so that all that exists is the spirit or the inspirational essence of experience. Some people might object to that and say, that's no memory. But that, if you think that way, you're ignoring the fact that everything that has come to be from that same state, from that same life spirit, where it was nothing more than the lucid light, the noumenal light of truth in spirit. It's difficult in such a state to discriminate past from future. And people who experience in a life spirit claim that it takes a very focused state of consciousness to tell what has been and what will be. It's understood much more like a logical equation than it is understood like the passage of time as seen by the change in forms in this physical world. One has to learn to understand the essence that is born in time. You have to learn a lot of other things too, because right now our consciousness is very crude and very limited. Our language that is a result of our experience here is also limited. We have very, very few words to describe the reality. And one of those few words is life. And life is the topic of this talk, obviously. But the word life is limited too. On one hand, life is used to describe the vital energy. On the other hand, it is used to describe the highest spiritual life in life spirit. Now, there is some correspondence between the two of them in that the vital life that we find here, or even as it becomes manifest in interstellar space, which is where life spirit functions, there's crystallization of etheric energy there, even without an etheric body like there is in the Earth. But at any rate, what we're talking about, there is a relationship in that the vitality and energy that we experience in this world are a reflective projection from life spirit. But that's a topic we do not have time to go into. But we can see that, it's something we go into every week. We have a healing prayer session here every week, and we try to draw on life spirit and produce fresh, very powerful etheric substance in the healing prayers. It's a hard, almost impossible thing to do, but we keep going at it year after year. But when we feel life here in this world, we feel peppy, and we feel vital, and we feel charged up. And that's a lot different from spiritual life. For me, the spiritual life, the little that I am aware of it, is almost like, more like joy than it is vitality. Like you're alive in the spirit, and it is really, really very good. One is alive in inspiration and in creativity. And boy, if you're doing something new, or even redoing, recreating something new, you really are alive. Some sides of this are grace and forgiveness. Grace or forgiveness says, yes, you did this and this, but there is this, the new from which everything else comes and that can make something different of it. Grace is that something that can take something that we've made dead and ugly and bring life and beauty into it or out of it. Well, I think every one of us has felt at least one time in life forgiveness for something that we've done. And we've all felt at least some little modicum of grace, or we wouldn't be Christians. We've all been reborn to some extent in those simple feelings, even if it's just if it's very little. It's a fact that our finest and rarest cultural achievements come from this, but they in themselves are not really as rich as life spirit itself. We've gotten so perverse that we love to feast on the husks of matter. In that, we're inordinately focused on things, whether they might be material things or thoughts or whatever, than we are on life. Life spirit is auto-focused in life, in itself. That's what it means for the bristling, brimming light that is radiant and rejuvenescent in and through and for itself. The life that we realized in the dot game didn't come from nourishing the forms, though it did that. It came from detachment from those forms, so it could love perfectly, and in that perfect disorganization could describe its being. No matter what the reason for our exile into matter, away from life spirit, we must have to become more subtle to experience it. We have to learn to see life indirectly, or the things of life indirectly, as we do in the dot game. We need to become more eternalistic. And at the same time, we are instantly rejuvenescent. Now, as mentioned in a past talk, life spirit is the attribute of feeling in the triad of willing, feeling, and thinking that describe the Godhead. Most of our feeling is not transcendental. Most of our feeling is in the desire world. Moreover, it is very egocentric and it's very personal, and neither of those are copacetic to life spirit. Can't be personal about life spirit. Consequently, our sentient understanding of life spirit is soapy. It's sentimental. We do have intuitive apperception of life spirit, and we understand its uniqueness in those moments. But when we try to put them into words, we do it sentimentally. Now, there are some very ingenious ways that this is done. The most common that probably everyone has heard is, life is what happens to you when you are busy with everything else. Now, there's meaningful eternity in that, and there's subtlety in that, and it blows off the insufficiency of it. There is an appreciation of life in the statement, but the ineffability of life, the what to us is mysterious, is just sort of blown off, saying, oh, I didn't get it. And it's like, let me go back to doing my busy work again and ignore life again. It doesn't grasp the wholeness of life because it's still earthbound. It's got that specialization, that particularization, and all the little things. We have other catchphrases for life. For example, if our dreams or our desires, which we have been obsessing on, are thwarted, in order to placate ourselves, we say something like, that's life. There is a surrender in a statement like, that's life, but and it's a surrender to something that's greater. But it demeans it. I don't know how to say what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say that the subtlety and appreciation of life, even if we have to come to it through trite and hackneyed statements from daily life, is something that requires a lot of sensitizing of ourselves. So we're trying to get at the spiritual meaning of life, which is not an easy thing to do. In some forms of Christian mysticism, the spiritual exercise for life spirit is called contemplation. And it's called contemplation to be in touch with life spirit itself. When I myself try to contemplate life spirit, and I try to do it every day, and I try to do it every day in healing work, one thought comes to mind above all others. And in contemplating life spirit, the word that comes up is purpose. Life spirit is purposeful. It is ultimately purposeful. In moments when we have altruistic flashes, we can experience that though all are lovable, and some are more lovable or more easily lovable, it's usually because they have purposeful lives. The people that I admire and that I look up to are people who have purpose. Usually, the more a person exhibits higher character, the more purposeful the life is. It's almost like there's an economy. It's not like a stinginess, but there's an economy that when you live purposefully, you don't waste yourself in dalliances of one kind or another. It's something much, much greater than that. States of beings and beings find purpose in whatever transcends them. The physical world, or the chemical region of the physical world, finds purpose in use, which is of the etheric subdivision. The whole physical world itself finds purpose in desire. And desire finds purpose in thought. And thought finds purpose in ideas. But when you get to life spirit finds purpose in itself. It is auto-purposeful. Now, this is because everything is within it, or everything is within for it or to it. Now at this point, obviously we're talking about something so transcendental and we are so earthbound that we are again talking gibberish. Now in these talks, this is the last talk on life spirit, in these talks we have gotten a few concepts about life spirit. In the last three talks we've talked about the primary attributes of life spirit. That is life, light, and love. So we've looked at all three of those, not in that order. And in the whole series of talks about Christ and life spirit, we have seen some very different, very disparate points of view of life spirit. All that remains is synthesis. And it can't be an artificial synthesis like putting together the pieces of a puzzle or something like that. It has to be spiritual synthesis, which means it cannot be done in pure mental activity. It can't be done in a talk like this. It has to be done inwardly. The concepts in these talks are means that I have found in trying to and being very modestly successful in experiencing life spirit. They're offered in the hope that one can hold several of them together in consciousness and in synthesis, use them as a springboard to the reality so that the forms drop away and the realization, the light that goes comes on in putting them together is what one experiences. These concepts have also been offered as a means to express whatever intuition or other life spirit experience we have. It's sort of like something we have a language of ideas and concepts which, though crude, are sufficiently subtle to grasp pure life spirit in a way that we can express it in some kind of word or some kind of means of expression. If we do try to synthesize and fully experience life spirit, we can take heart in the fact that that is the very nature of life spirit. Life spirit is pure unity. We've been saying all along in these recent talks that in life spirit is when opposites merge paradoxically into unity. And creatively, they emerge from that unity. And the opposites that hold things together in reality are emanations from the paradoxical unity of life spirit. So what we're trying to do in synthesis is right in nature with life spirit. In fact, the Greeks used to call life spirit intellect with a capital I. And that intellect is still found today in modern Christian mysticism. The experience that comes out of the ethers when it is taken into spirit is taken into life spirit. And it becomes intellectual soul. So the word intellect goes back to that understanding. And isn't it really interesting, the paradoxical thing that the nature of the ethers, one of the things that we described it as being different from all of the other worlds, was polarity. And that the polarity of the ethers is a reflection of the paradox in unity in life spirit. It's just beautiful the way all of these things work out. So the sympathies and antipathies that we have from seeing both sides of a cause and consequence relationship that are precipitations of life spirit in this world find their resolution in the same way that concepts or creative principles find their resolution in the unity of life spirit. Next time, we'll try to speak a little bit about divine spirit, which will probably take us even into deeper silliness, and we'll try to even go a little bit beyond divine spirit. Just a few little ideas. We can't at all hope to be comprehensive or anything like that. It's so far beyond us. And in the last talk, we'll talk about pure cosmography, the location of things and what that all means. All right, thank you very much.